This conference will now be.
हेलो हेलो गाइस, डू यू हियर मी और नॉट? ओके,
यस सर।
हाय गाइस, हर्षिनी हर्षिनी
हाय हेलो।
या यू आर न्यू टुडे आर यू ऑलरेडी जॉइंड अप?
आई जॉइन वन क्लास,
Which one class no?
द लास्ट वन, एक्सेप्शंस।
Okay, before?
नो, आई हैव जॉइन न्यूली।
Okay, so what do you understand? Do you understand all?
या एक्सेप्शंस आई हैव अंडरस्टूड। आई एम गोइंग थ्रू द फर्स्ट क्लासेस। आई गॉट द लिंक, सो आई एम गोइंग थ्रू देम।
Okay. Right.
या थैंक यू।
Hello guys. Guys, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Right, so where we were in the last session, guys? Exception, right? Exception handling. I shown you how to deal with the predefined exception and user defined exception. Okay, now. So what is the use of throw keyword, guys? Anybody? What is the use of throw keyword? Posh.
So I cannot see the screen.
No,
hello?
I don't know. I am not sharing screen. Tell me, what is the use of throw keyword?
Throw keyword we are using for the user defined. If we need to catch some exception by user defined, I mean, if we need to catch the exception, user defined exception, then we need to use the throw keyword.
Okay.
The exception before it catches, that is the use of throw keyword.
Yeah, throw keyword is explicitly throws an exception rather than JVM does. But when we go for throw keyword, when we want to deal with our own exception, user defined exception. Correct? See here, I am checking for age. We know which is valid age, we know which is invalid age, so we better can handle the age. So I'm checking the user given age is valid or not. In my range 1 to 130 is valid. I can decide. JVM cannot decide. Yes, if it is, I'm just storing the value successfully. Otherwise, I'm throwing an exception called age exception, which I have created myself. Guys, do remember this point. How to create own exception? This is the way how to create the own exception. Okay, now? Okay, now, guys?
Yes.
Right. Now, in this same way, we'll also look. Yeah, still, so far we have seen try, catch, throw. Now we'll also look into throws keyword. Throws keyword. What is throws keyword? So now let me go with this next package. New package. Day dot. What is the day today? Day dot theme. And let me take into program, copy this program and paste it into day 15. Yes. Now let me explain what is the use of throw keyword. Sorry, throws keyword. Throw and throws. Throw, you know, to raise the exception. What is throw? We'll see. Now I'm removing this. Right. I'm removing this try catch. What have you seen when I remove try catch? And after, if there is some exception is being raised, it will always expect you to handle, right? Always expect you to handle the exception. Okay. Now, can guys, anybody tell me why it is giving me error and why it is forcing me to handle the exception with the try catch or throws keyword? Why it did not force me in other case here are 13. Let me take very basic. Yes, here you look at it. When I was getting exception something by zero, arithmetic exception, tell me why it is not forcing at all if I don't write a try catch blocks here. Anybody? Is it forcing me to? There is a arithmetic exception, you handle it. Does compiler is forcing me or not?
No.
And when I run the program, does the exception is raising or not?
Yes.
We got the exception. But why did not forced me? Why I myself, I have try catch blocks added here. And why it is, did you observe this? When I did something like this, okay, throw keyword or any other, not only this, if I use something else also, in some cases it will force me, in some cases it doesn't force me. What is the difference between these two things?
Because one is checked exception.
Yes,
because one is checked exception. And
this, yeah, this type of exceptions which are forcing to handle called checked exception. Guys, this is most important. And the exceptions which are not forcing but still they are throwing exception, unchecked exception. Yes, go ahead. What is the difference between checked and unchecked? If somebody asks you, explain about checked and unchecked exception, how do you explain? Nice.
Check is a runtime exception. When you create the program, that time you know during the runtime, and the other one is the compile time exception.
What do you mean by compile time exception and runtime exception? Exception will be occurred at compile time or runtime? Tell me when the exception will be occurred. Any exception?
Compile time.
Was
runtime.
Okay, tell me, this is compile time or runtime? So when this exception will occur, runtime or compile time? Runtime only. If runtime your value is wrong, it will throw exception, right?
Yeah.
So any exception will occur at runtime, not compile time. Do remember.
Okay.
But what is the difference between checked and unchecked?
If we give check the exception, it will go and check the exception. If we give uncheck it, it will not check.
I didn't catch your point, ma. Okay, let me explain. Is it predefined method or our values? Is it predefined method operating or we are doing some operation? What do you think of it?
We are doing
very good. Let me go to this. This is what type of exception? Array index out of bounds exception, right?
Yeah.
Is there any predefined method working? Is there any predefined method throwing an exception or your operation is throwing an exception? The exception is raised. Our operation. Guys. Okay. This is not a predefined method. If it is a predefined method like this, which is throwing an exception, JVM and compiler both knows that this may throw an exception. But this is not a predefined method, guys. This is an operator working on your variables. This is also like an array operator. This is not a predefined method. So compiler doesn't care about it. Compiler knows about the methods only. When you write a method, compiler can identify what type of method, what is the behavior of method, and what is it exactly doing. So that's what, when you use predefined methods and the method is throwing an exception, for example, if the method is throwing an exception, then compiler will react. Other than methods, compiler will not react. So when compiler is reacting and it's asking you to handle, it's forcing you to handle, they are called as checked exception, because compiler is checking. What compiler is checking? Not for exceptions. Compiler is checking for what? Compiler is checking for handled or not. And compiler is telling you what? Compiler suggesting you to handle this exception. Guys, compiler is checking for what? Whether you used try catch blocks or not. That is what? Checked exception. If compiler checks whether you handled exception or not, it is called as checked exception. I hope I'm clear, guys. If compiler doesn't check, does compiler is checking? No, because it's not a method. Compiler don't know about it. Okay, so it is called as unchecked exception. But in both the cases, if something goes wrong, exception will raise in both the cases. But one is checked by the compiler, other one is not checked by the compiler. Okay, let me give you another example. If let's take, it's a rainy season. In the rainy season, if you are going out of your home, okay, either parents or brother, sister, somebody, they will ask whether you take umbrella or not, or your parent is going, your father is going out of the home, you suggest that ki papa take the umbrella. Why? Because it's a rainy season. Yes or no, guys?
Yes.
Yes. Will you same thing, will you ask in winter?
No.
No. Because there is less chance or no chance of rain. But in rainy season, there is a mandatory, it will be a rain. And based on the situation, you will ask and you will force him to take some umbrella, or you will ask him to take a jacket, okay, to prevent yourself, you know, rain exception. Okay, but in normal situation, okay, and you will never force him, but still there is a chance of getting rain or not. Yes, even in winter or summer, there will be chance of getting rain, but you will never force them in the other seasons rather than the rainy season. Why? Because you know that's what you are suggesting, you are forcing. You understand my point? That is kind of a checked exception. When your kids or when your brothers going to examination, you will force them to check for the hall ticket. You will force them to take extra pen. Guys, are you getting my point? Why you force them? Why don't you force every time when he is going to school or college? Why don't you force? Because it's most important period. There may be a chance of pen failure. Okay, there may be a chance of you may forget your hall ticket. This is an important situation. So you know that. So that's what you are forcing. You are asking him to take it extra things. Guys, you understand my point? Similarly, when compiler knows and it is forcing you and it is asking you to handle, that is called as checked exception. But in both the cases, there is a chance of exception only. But compiler doesn't check, that's a different case. Compiler checks, that's a different case. I hope you understand. What is checked exception? Checked exception is exception which are checked by the compiler whether they handled or not. So remember this point, guys. Okay. So next, let me come back to our previous problem. So this is comes under checked exception. If you go to diagram, our previous diagram also, the right side of exception are unchecked exception, the left side are checked exception, IO exception, SQL exception, lot of exceptions will be there. And a runtime exception, arithmetic, null pointer, okay, array index or the bounds, many exceptions are there. So there are two categories, checked and unchecked exceptions. So the exception which you are creating also coming under checked exception. Why it is coming under checked exception? Because your exception class is the direct subclass of what? Exception class. You observe, if any class is IO exception, SQL exception, is there any parent between exception and this? No. IO exception is direct child for exception. SQL exception is a direct child for exception. But if you go to arithmetic exception, it's not direct child for exception. It is a child for runtime exception. Do remember. So when I create my own exception, do I take runtime exception or checked exception? I take checked exception, which is predefined. So this is my checked exception. That's what it is forcing to handle. Two ways. Handling is two ways. One is what? One is what? So now let me show you another point. I handle and you see here when I remove this try and catch. Now it is forcing me to do two things. Either you add throws declaration or you surrender with a try catch block. So you know already try catch means exception handling. Okay, what is the second option? Throws declaration. See, the throws your exception in the method level. Now it is cool. See, it is cool. Yes, but that exception is handled or not? No, you go and check in the main method. You are getting errors. Why you are getting error in the main method?
Because we are calling person inside the main method.
Sorry?
Because we are calling the person constructor inside the main method, right?
Yes. So when you say throws now, what do you mean by that? This method is saying I have an exception, I have a chance of getting exception in my statements, but I am not handling this exception. My caller will handle this exception. If you write throws means it says I am not going to handle the exception. I am my caller is responsible to handle the exception. So it is propagating the exception handling responsibility to the caller. Now come back to the caller. Who is the caller? Yeah, this is the caller, right? From main method, you are calling the above constructor. So now it is getting error. What? It is also same. Add throws or surrender with a try catch. If you put surrender with a try catch, the exception handling is done here itself. If you put throws again, it will propagating the exception handling responsibility to its caller. Who is the caller of main method, guys?
JVM.
Very good. So now who will take care of exception handling?
JVM.
Like this is the throw is something different. Throws is something different. If you write throws means it is propagating the exception handling responsibility to the next caller, next layer. So this is what propagation of exception handling. whether you want to handle or your caller will handle. Okay, if your caller wants to handle, you just write try catch blocks here. Your job is done. See, I'll put all here. Okay, now exception handling is done, guys. Okay, now the next point is, what, why should I propagate? What happens if I handle there? It depends upon the requirement. In real time, what happens? I'll tell you. Okay, let us go to the ATM machine. Assume the user is using at ATM machine, and in the back end bank account, assume there are there. Guys, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes. This is ATM front end program, and this is a bank server. Assume it's a middle layer, and it is a database server, DB server. There are different layers in real time. Okay, now suppose assume somewhere exception is, these are interconnected. This is operated by the user. Who is operating? User is operating, correct? User is operating this. Now whatever the problem is happening inside the bank server or the DB server, okay, suppose some exception happened and you handled with try catch here itself, okay, does the ATM machine can display the message or only bank server can display the message? Tell me, guys. When you write the try catch blocks, you are just writing the error messages in the try catch block only, no? Itself, no, wherever you are handling, you are writing the catch block messages there itself, right? So that particular server machine can display the messages rather than that reaches to the ATM machine, because user has to know what happened in the back end now. So if you don't want to handle and you want to propagate to the caller, okay, you say throws here and ATM machine will handle and it will show the messages to the end user. Now we understand what is the use of throws. If you want to, okay, raise the messages or you want to give the acknowledgement to the end user or next layer, you can propagate rather than you handle it. That is what throws keyword, guys. Guys, are you clear? Are any doubt regarding throws keyword? Now, this method is saying throws and the error machine, error is coming over here, you handle. If you handle here, you can handle. Otherwise, you can handle here. So I am showing in one program, but in real time, this will be the situation. Shall I move forward, guys? Everybody got clarity or not?
Yes.
Throws, try, catch. This is the exception handling. Okay, now next, let me move into the next concept. Multi-threading. What is multi-threading? I mean, what is thread? First of all, we should understand what is thread. What is thread? What is the use of thread? So multiple threads, multi-thread. Why multi-thread? For multitasking, for executing many tasks at a time. Anybody else would like to speak about multi-threading, guys? Multi-threading. Look at this. Look at these images. Multi-threading means what? Guys, okay, now we are working with the GoToMeeting. We are working with techniques. We are also working with MS Paint. Multiple applications we opened, and we are working with many applications. This is what multitasking, no? Multitasking means working with many applications at a time. That is multitasking. Okay, now guys, respond.
Yes, sir.
So multitasking means there are two types of process based multitasking, thread based multitasking. The one we are doing right now is process based multitasking. We no need to worry about it because operating system will take care about it, OS. But when it comes to thread based multitasking, you take care of as a programmer's responsibility. We'll discuss about this later. First, we'll understand exactly how multitasking happens. Assume I opened one program, second program, third program, multiple programs or applications like we did now. How one processor in the machine working with all this at a time? Boss, processor will do only one job at a time, not multiple jobs at a time. Do remember this point. But how these all being executed at a time? How we are able to listen our voice, how we are able to see our screen, and how I am able to run my project in the same machine. How it is happening? So context switching process means what? See, whenever you open an application, one process will be created in Windows. Process, process, process. Three applications, three processes. So what happens when processor looks, the processor will find three or four multiple processes in the system. Then rather than working for only one particular process, it will share the time between all the processes. Okay, means what? See guys, it's a separate path of execution, process or thread. You can call like a separate path of execution. Means what? Processor goes to take the first process and it will spend some time, assume some 10 milliseconds or microseconds with the program one. Okay, and leave it and go to the second program. Again, it will spend 10 milliseconds or 10 microseconds or 1 millisecond. It's not fixed time based on the processor and thread scheduler. Again, it will go to the program three. Okay, guys, it is not finishing the first second task. It is just spending some time with the particular task and going to the next task. Do remember. Then it is going to third task. After finishing that particular 1, 2, 3 microseconds, it is coming back to the first task, guys. Why it is coming back to the first task? The program task is not completed, still it is there. So it will resume the process for again 5 milliseconds or 1 millisecond or 2 milliseconds according to the time slicing process. Again, it will go catch the second program, execute it for 1 millisecond, 2 millisecond, microsecond, then it will go to the program. Round robin algorithm. In the form of round robin algorithm, will process all the programs one by one, one by one. Not complete program do. It is slicing the program, guys. So we feel that because of the speed of the processor, catching each program very quickly and let it execute. Okay, then we feel that everything is working simultaneously, concurrently. That is the multitasking operating, multitasking operation. So at a time, all tasks are not happening. Context switching happening between, like, you know, the Pani Puri guy will serve 5 members, 1, 1, 1, 1, then come back to the first person, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2. Everybody is busy, you know. You can assume like that. So first, it will spend with first program, go to the second program, go to third program, until first process is completed, it is coming back to the first program, then again resuming. So we feel that first program is running, second program is running, third program. Guys, are you clear with this or not? Let me know. Everyone.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So now this is okay. We are not worrying about it. Why are we worrying about other things? Because threads concept. If you take the difference, there are multiple applications are working, and here if you look at it in app, one application, many tasks inside the application. One application, many tasks in the application. Okay. So it is a programmer's responsibility, right? When you're writing a big program or application, you, if you need different classes or different methods in your program to do the multitasking rather than sequential tasking, then your responsibility to the same whatever OS has done. OS used processes, you use a thread. So you create a thread and attach to the task one, create a thread attached to task two, create thread attached to task three. Now what happens similarly, whatever you did with the process, it will, you will be seen here in the threads concept. So when processor find multiple threads now, it will again process the time sharing, okay? Then it will execute all the tasks concurrently rather than sequential execution. Sequential, generally what happens in Java also, one thread generally created by JVM and executed all the tasks with one thread, that is called as main thread, guys. So if you have three classes or three methods, JVM will create one main thread and execute the first task. After completion of the first task, it will go to the second task. Then after completion of the second task, it will go to the third task. It is sequential execution, guys. The problem is what? If the three tasks are independent tasks, why should the task two and task three has to wait until task one has to complete, guys? You understand my point? Why should I wait until task one complete? When there is no relation between task one, task two, task three, then you can independently run them independently, na? So that I can finish. Assume if task one takes total 20 minutes and task two takes only 5 minutes, okay? Or task three takes 3 minutes. So if it is going sequentially, how many minutes has to wait for task three to complete its download or its execution? Tell me, guys. 20, 25, and 3. So task 3 has to wait 25 minutes, right? Guys, task 3 has to wait how many minutes? The 25 minutes. Has to wait. It is loss of time. So rather than waiting, if all threads are working simultaneously, then what happens within 3 minutes, the task three will finish, task two and task one will continue. Once the task two is finished in 5 minutes, then task one will continue, like your downloads, right? Why should I wait when I'm downloading multiple things, one movie I'm downloading, one small clip I'm downloading. So if it is multi-threading, what happens? Clip is downloaded in 10 minutes, then movie will download in 20, 30, 40 minutes. So why should this has to wait? I can download the clip and I can watch it. I can complete other task until the movie downloads. Yes or no? So this is the advantage of multi-threading, guys. So within the program, if you want to perform multitasking, go with the threads concept. And whatever we are doing right now, it's a process-based multitasking concept. So now everybody understand why you need thread. When you want multitasking inside the one program, single program, then you need to go with thread. Okay, guys. So do you have any already one thread in Java program? Yes, there is already JVM creating one thread, main thread, which is running all our program. One thread is running all our program. Now you want different threads. You create child threads. They are called as child threads. And how to create threads in Java? Java provides a lot of facilities. We can use the facilities like classes. Okay. Right, guys. So let us go into program. How to create a thread? Very simple. I'll show you the process. First step, create a class by extending thread class. The thread is a class given by Java. Like in exception, Java has given a class to create exception. Now, similarly, Java has given a class called thread. You have to inherit that class into your class. So your class will become a thread also. And the second process, override run method. Override run method with your code. Override run method with your code. Third, create object for your class. Fourth step, invoke start method, which automatically invokes run method. That's the program process. So let me create a basic class, my thread. Insert thread. Now my class has become thread, guys. Do remember. Now my class has become thread. What is the second step? Override the run method. There is a run method in thread class. You have to override it. Public void run. Then write your code. Whatever. I'll just print I less than or equals to 10. I plus plus. Dot out dot println. I guess. Okay, na? So one is over. Second one is over. Now third one, create object. Yeah, generally we used to create object for the class. Now if you want all the methods, yes, I create object for this my thread class. New object name is small letter. Guys, I created object for the MyThread class. I call which method now? Generally, we used to call the existing method. Which method is there? Run method, correct? Yeah. If you call the run method will run. See, guys, 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This is normal process. But in threads, what we supposed to do? Do we call run method directly or you call start method? You need to call not to run method, you call start method. Stop this. Boss, you write the code in run method and you are calling start method. Let us see what will happen. What is the output, guys? Same output or different output? You are getting same output, no? This is what thread sponsor. This is what thread concept is. Am I clear? Guys, is that clear or not? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes. Okay. So, but what is the difference between calling start method or run method? In both cases, I am getting the output. Now, there is no issue, Pada. There is no issue at all in both the cases. But if you want to look what is the problem, I'll just do one thing. I'll print thread dot current thread. Means what I am doing, you know, I am printing the name of the thread, details of the thread, which is running my main method, guys. In the main method, if you are printing, this means current thread information. Same thing I will print in the run. So the current thread, who is executing run method, it will display. Let us check now. Guys, what is the first thread? What is the first thread and what is the second thread? Both are same or different?
First is main thread, second is thread G.
Both are same or different? Different. Means you got two different threads or same thread is working two times? I mean, two classes are run by same thread or two classes are run by different threads?
Different.
Now let me go with the run method directly. I will call run method directly. Now check. Both classes are running by one method or differently running? How many threads are there in my program right now? So main method is executed by the main thread, run method also executed by the main thread only. Am I correct or not?
Yes, sir.
So what do you understand with this? If you want to create a new thread, do you go for run method directly or you should go with the start method? If you run the start method, okay, the request goes to thread scheduler. Then thread scheduler will assign the timing for each thread, then it creates a new thread. If you don't invoke start method, it won't go to thread scheduler, it will directly go to the normal process without thread scheduler. So no thread is created. This is the way of creating thread in Java, guys. Guys, now you look at it, thread hyphen zero. The second one, five, means what? It's a priority of the thread. And the last one, group of the thread. Groups are same priority. I mean, every thread is having a priority, guys. 1 to 10 numbers. One is the low priority, 10 is the high priority, and 5 is the main normal priority, medium priority. Every thread is created by normal priority. Do remember this point, okay? Every thread is created by normal priority. Okay, now if you want to change the name of the thread, you can change the name of the thread. See, thread hyphen zero, thread hyphen one. I can change this name to different name. How can I change? Yeah, after you create thread, my thread dot set name. There are a lot of methods in the thread. My thread. See now, rather than thread 0, thread 1, thread 2, they'll print what? My thread. Name is changed. If you want to change the priority, you can just say my thread dot set priority. Then check. See, your priority got changed to 10. So like that, you can change whatever you want. Guys, do remember, there are a lot of methods in a thread class. So this is the way how we create the thread, guys.
Sir, set priority means what, sir? Set priority.
Set priority means I'm changing the priority of the thread. Initially, what was the priority? What was the priority? Thread priority by default 5 for every thread. Now it was 5 before. After change, it became thread priority 10. So whether thread thread contains high priority like 10, 9, 8, then it will execute, okay, very quickly. If there are three threads, okay, among those one thread is having higher priority, one thread is having lower priority, then processor will run more times that higher priority. You are in queue. If any VIP comes, will he wait or will he go directly and take the tickets? Because he is having higher priority, no? Who first enter, VIP or you?
The VIP, so if it is 10 means it is higher priority, sir.
Higher priority. 1 means low, normal 5. You can give 3, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, anything as per your requirement.
So,
okay, na? So this
is reaching it first, am I right, sir?
Yes. Lower priority later. Okay. Yes, ma'am. So this is the way how we create threads. There is one more way, and how to deal with multi-threading and all, we'll discuss next session, guys. So go ahead with this video, try to understand very clearly all the steps, then we'll discuss rest of the things in the next session, guys. Okay.
Sir, I have a question. Among all, yes, then main thread has highest priority, right?
No. Main also having same priority, no? See, only, no? Every thread is burned with the 5, not more than that. That's then up to you how you want to run.
Yeah, if we, yes, set priority 10 to my thread, then...
Then any thread will become higher priority as your choice what you want.
Yeah, that means it will be execute before the other threads, right, sir?
Yes, it will finish quickly now.
Finish, right? Not start.
Yes, it will. Yeah, start and finish.
Start and
will
finish.
Right? Start. It will start and it will also let other to start. Then it will finish. There is nothing now in the main. It will wake up other and it will go sleep. Then this will continue its job. Understand my point?
I not that much clear, sir. That's why I am thinking.
See. Forget about priorities.
Okay.
This is okay. But now main method is doing what? First, it is saying the thread information. It is creating object for the child. It is setting the name. Then it is starting the thread. What I will do after this is system.out.println main closed or main is ended. Here I will write system.out.println child is ended. Who ends first? Who ends text? Tell me now. I'll put 100 or I'll put 10. Okay. Who ends first? Let's check. Who ended last?
Child.
Who ended first?
Main.
That's it. So what main has done? Main has hit the request. Main initiated this thread. And main's job is over, no?
Yes.
It keep on printing its job. It keep on doing its job. It left. You understand my point?
Yes.
Because it doesn't have anything to do, no? It has lot of things to do. You got my point?
Yes.
Because multi-threading, no, it's not sequential execution. No? If there is no multi-threading, what will happen if I use for example, run method. Now you check. If I use run method, no multi-threading. No? See, first child ended, then main ended. Why? Why like this? Because sequential execution, no?
Oh,
sequential means what? When this run method is being called, it will go and hit the run method, finish the job. After finishing, it will come back to this, no, and it will print this, no.
Yes.
Because only one thread is working. You got my point?
Yes.
Suppose you visit one first shop, you order the items, you go to the second shop, you order other items, and you only the one collecting all the items. So you will come back to the first shop after the second shop, right? Then collect the items, come to home. Otherwise, if two people along with you, you will give the authority to the first person, you go and collect from there, I will go there. And you will go to the second shop and you will collect the items. If your items are very less, and the first shop, the other person's items are very high, okay, he is purchasing 100 items, you are purchasing only 5 items. So who will reach home first? If you are independent.
If the list item by the person who buy the list item.
Less, very simple, no?
Yeah.
Got it? And you only the one person. You only the one person. You have to wait. No, even you collected from the second shop 5 items, you will come to the second shop. You have to wait under 100 items to be collected. No, you, because only one person is doing all the job. And you will reach home very late, no? After collecting both items, no?
Yes.
Your main has to wait until this complete or not?
Yeah, until it's complete.
Why? Because only one thread is working, no?
Yes.
If there are multiple threads, so main's job is over. Main doesn't care about it because it is executed by other thread, no? Why main will wait for it? See, main is ended already. Other thread is taking his job, continue till end, it's over.
Yes, then if we set the priority for some other methods, then it should be finished first.
It depends. I can't say like that, because main has only one to print, this has 10 items to print. For example, you set 10 times priority, you set one time priority. Do you think main will finish or sub will finish? What do you think? Even though it is heavy component, right? Main has still one item only to print, no?
Yeah.
After this, main has only one statement, but still it has to go and print, then 10 times numbers, then this one, right? Even higher priority also, it will not end up. Main only end up, because job of the main is very short now. You compare when you have big job, two threads. There are two threads which are printing 10-10. I will show you priority. Don't include the priority with your question. Priority is different, your question is different, I think.
Okay.
You are looking for priority effect, you wait for the next session. If you want other things, you ask me now.
Okay, sir, I got clarity.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Right, bye, everyone.
Okay, bye.
Awesome.
Okay, bye, everyone. Just go ahead, practice.